gone, people. Did you know they're calling for snow? And just 2 days ago, I mowed a yard. Weird. Anyway, before we get into today's video, Gracie has something she wants to say about the coronavirus. Here's Gracie.
You got a friend in me.
Everything's gonna be fine. You just need to believe. Clap your hands if you believe. Everything is okay!
In this video today, I'm going to be talking about the seven seals that it mentions in Revelations. And as far as I can tell, the only left two things left in prophecy is the two witnesses and the Antichrist going in declaring himself God, which I think will be gone by the time that happens, or that'll happen and then we'll be gone. And Kramer just popped in. Anyway, enough to drive a person insane. What I was going to tell you, if you read Matthew 24 and Revelation 6 side by side, Matthew 24, Jesus is telling you what's going to happen. And in Revelations, it tells you when it happens and how it happens. They coincide together, so you'll have to check that out. I put like a little video with this that it kind of explains more about like the four horsemen and the seven seals, which I found so fascinating, very interesting. But I do believe that we're really close to the end. I really do, people, and I'm not just saying that. I think we're close to the end. And I'm glad I'm all right, ain't you? Gotta drink me some milk. Good for the body, you know, and the bones. Anyway, I hope you guys are doing all right. I think the corona thing is gonna blow over. I really do, and I think everybody's gonna be all right. Even though our state is on lockdown now, but you know, we gotta go along with the rest of the group, right? It's always something. Life's always going to throw things at you, ain't it? You know, the minute everything's going right, bam. But you know something? I did find out that where everybody's been having to stay home and on lockdown in these big cities and all that, air pollution's down and the ocean's just cleaning itself, you know. So maybe it could be a good thing. But I do think things are going to change. Everything's going to be a whole lot different. Because you stop and think about it. All these companies that said people can't work from home, that it's impossible for some of these people to work at home. Now, I know some people do work from home. But some of these companies could let their employees work from home, and they're like, we can't do that. Well, now, they're doing that. So, was they lying? I guess so, right? And look at all the money that the government is sending out to everybody, which is a great thing. Trust me, I need it just like everybody else. But that could have helped a lot of programs in the past that didn't get no funding. You know what I mean? So they just choose what they want to do. Anyway, we ain't of this world, though, are we? We just passing through this place. And I'm ready to graduate. Let's hope everybody else is going to graduate with me. I don't know. Anyway, I do think, though, that everybody does need to have your own personal walk with Jesus. We really do. Everybody needs to do that. I mean, you know, you don't have to be in a church house. We are the church. These people forgot that. They act like it's a big deal because nobody can go to these churches because of the coronavirus and all this stuff. That's just a building, people. We are the church. We are. the people are, you know. Check in on your neighbors, especially if they're elderly. Make sure they got things they need, you know. I do see a lot of changes coming for us, and I do hope they're better, a lot better. But the Bible says it's only going to get worse from here. But we can hope, right? If we go by what the Bible says, I'm looking for them to start finding ways to get rid of money and enforce the chip. That's when it's going to get bad, people. It really will. And it talks about darkness, the sun and the moon not giving its light. Alice, the Bible tells you these things are coming. Don't act like they're not going to happen. Be prepared if you can, you know. Well, here comes some guardians. Happens every time. They have to make sure I'm protected, I'm sure. I'm over here at the down from the middle school, because school's out, so I figured there'd be nobody here, but there they come, walking out the road, people, you know. But I took my grandbabies back to their mommy a while ago, and drove through Church Hill, and it's dead as a hammer, just like it is on Sunday. Every Sunday it's dead as a hammer, but it's really dead today. Ain't no businesses open, hardly, at all. Down through the middle of Church Hill, you know. Of course, everything's about left Church Hill. But, anyway, don't forget, wash your hands, people. Okay? Wash your hands. And don't be in big crowds. But do take time to step out a little bit and get you some air, even if it's raining. It's a good day, you know, to lay in the house and watch TV. What I plan on doing after a while. Make some supper. I'm gonna eat my supper. Put my pajamas on early and watch TV. Just chill for a while. Ain't a thing wrong with that, is there? Well, I think we're gonna make it through this. Don't you? I hope you like what I'm attaching to this video. I mean, it's really interesting. And I really like it. You know, a lot of people don't understand, like the four horsemen, they don't understand the seals, what all that means. And this will explain it. It's really cool. But the pestilence that it talks about and all that, this has been happening. All these have slowly happened over all these years. Just think now, seriously, on a serious note, we are so lucky. Because we're the generation that gets to see it all happening. Now think of all, like our grandparents, great-grandparents, all them down in the past. They knew all this was coming. They even told everybody, you know, the Lord's coming and all this stuff. But we actually get to see it happen. That's what's really cool. What is it says about the people that's not seen and believed? That'd be us, you know, which is cool. Anyway, I hope you have a good day today. And if you ain't said the words, I love you, do it. Say it to people. It's just like we hear about people, friends that die, that we've had for years, you know. And when you seen that person last, stop and think. I mean, you know, was I nice to that person? Did I ignore that person? Try to look at it like that, you know. The last thing you say to people may be the last thing you say to people. Make sure it's nice what you send out, because it always comes back eventually. Always. See what I'm saying? You see that? I know, I'm trying not to let it bother me. They just drive by and go, Not smile, nothing. People are flipping out. You hear me? What happened to human kindness, people? What would have been wrong when that truck drove by that they went? That would have been nice, but no, they go. I know, shut up, Dana. I'm so ready to check out of this planet. Hey, I tell you this much. When we all get to heaven, Jesus said that he's going to prepare a place for me, right? All right, then. At my place, I'm having a gathering, okay? If you get to my place, stop by and visit. We'll hang out. Okay? I love you. Peace.
And open the scroll, but no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth could open the scroll or even look inside it. The seven seals represent seven revelations about Jesus. When the Father wrote the book of life, he foreknew the rise of sin, and he foreknew that Jesus would die for sinners. This is why John says Jesus is the slain lamb from the foundation of the world. As each seal is broken, a truth about Jesus is disseminated through heaven and earth. A rider on a white horse sets out to conquer. A rider on a red horse causes conflict and war. A rider on a black horse warns of judgment. A rider on a pale horse brings about devastation. Martyrs for truth's sake, the slain righteous cry out for justice. The second coming. The moon turns red before the imminent coming of Christ. Silence for a half an hour, Jesus passes final judgments upon the resurrected wicked. The four horses are not entirely exclusive to Revelation. Zechariah saw four horses having the same colors. Zechariah was told the four horses represent the four spirits of heaven that stand in the presence of the Lord of the whole world. They go throughout the earth at God's command to accomplish His will. Zechariah saw the black horse go north, the white horse go west, the pale horse go south, and the red horse go to the east. Again, these horses go throughout the world. The four living creatures might be thought of as senior angels within the heavenly host, having great responsibility. They are appointed to carry out special services throughout the universe of God. They ensure that God's desires are carried out. The seals begin. Each horse and their rider represent the works or actions of the four living creatures. As Jesus opens each seal, He commissions a specific process that leads to the conclusion of the plan of salvation. The effect and influence of the seals is both cumulative and associative. This means that the conquering initiated in the first seal starts there and finishes during the sixth seal. The process that unfolds in seal 2 reaches its height during the fifth seal, and the understanding of seal 3 prepares understanding for the events that transpire during the opening of the fourth seal. The events during the breaking of the seal do not begin and end in order for the next one to be broken. Rather, the first three seals begin certain events that remain in motion until their counterpart concludes their work. It was for this very reason that Jesus was given sovereign power. He starts these three events that He will personally oversee. He must manage the outcome of each process so that the gospel can accomplish its task. Jesus sends the four living creatures to earth with special assignments. As each prepares to do its work, John is observing in the vision. They each say to John, "Come."
The original Greek says a laurel wreath, the ancient symbol of a conquering victor. But what does it all mean? This horseman has often been confused with the returning Christ, described in chapter 19 of the same book, because he also rides a white horse. Many believe that the first rider pictures the gradual triumph of organized Christian religion beginning 2,000 years ago. But Revelation 19 reveals a different individual than chapter 6. The returning Christ is dressed in a robe stained with blood, wearing multiple crowns. The Greek is diadems, not a laurel wreath. He is accompanied by angelic beings on white horses, and his weapon is the sword of his mouth, not a bow. The obvious differences between the two images suggest that the first of the four horsemen represents a counterfeit or false Messiah. And this is exactly what we find in the explanation that Jesus himself gave to his disciples more than 60 years before this vision, as he told them about the future progression of world conditions. The disciples asked, "What will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age?" Jesus first warned that events seeming to indicate the end is imminent do not necessarily mean that it is. He said, "Take heed that no one deceives you." Then he added the first global condition to be aware of. "For many will come in my name, saying, 'I am the Christ,' and will deceive many." In a parallel account, the same deceivers claim, "I am He." Jesus' warning here about not being fooled parallels the first broken seal in the book of Revelation. He clearly identifies the white horse and its rider. People who claim to be the Anointed One are false messiahs, men who counterfeit the future role of the true returning Christ. A counterfeit is not easy to spot. It's so close that it could be the real thing, except to the trained eye. So Jesus warned against being deceived by human beings who claim to be the Messiah. That's to say, specially chosen and anointed by God to rule. Such people present themselves as the only ones who can solve all problems. Others have combined religion and politics in their efforts to be the anointed one. Take the 4th century Roman Emperor Constantine. He's the man credited with Christianizing the Roman Empire. Yet his claims to be equal with the apostles, even God's agent, were not borne out by his behavior. Other more recent examples include Napoleon, Stalin, Mussolini, Hitler, and Mao Zedong. All of them took advantage of the language of religion and its imagery, stirring up religious fervor, and got their followers to worship them, believing they had all the answers. Of course, all these false messiahs failed precisely because they were false. They also brought great destruction on the world, including their own people. In many cases, millions died because of their violent rule, their purges, and their wars. Deceit comes in many forms, and the counterfeit white horseman will continue to ride until he's vanquished by Christ at his coming. Almost every one of these false messiahs led their followers into war, and that's the same next step in the sequence of the four riders. In the wake of false messiahs would come the scourge of war, represented by the rider of the red horse. Yet even widespread war would not necessarily mean the end was imminent. Take heed that no one deceives you, he said. Then Jesus added, you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you're not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet, for nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. Till the end, because it is a natural consequence of false claims, wrong ideas, misguided policies, and ruinous philosophies put forward by leaders with selfish ambitions. Napoleon Bonaparte is an obvious example and incarnation of the first warrior astride the white horse. He was famously shown wearing a victor's laurel wreath in both life and death. His leadership also brought the Red Horseman at full gallop onto the world scene. Between 1792 and 1815, France was at war with four colonial powers: the Spanish, the Dutch, the Portuguese, and the British. Napoleon's aggression took his forces to almost every corner of the world. Like so many before him, Napoleon positioned himself as a messiah. But he proved false, and he promoted the Red Horseman's ride. Joseph Stalin's 20th century record was certainly worse. Violence and war, domestic and international, characterized his regime. Cynical manipulation of religious sentiment underscored the duplicity of what in pure numbers was arguably one of the most murderous regimes in history. We could talk in detail about the warfare and violence of other false messiahs of the 20th century, including Mussolini and Mao, Cambodia's Pol Pot, and the Kim regime of North Korea. The story would be the same: totalitarian cruelty, imprisonment, and the deaths of millions. The Red Horseman rides in the wake of the false messiah. False Christs bring on total war. When Jesus told his disciples about the conditions that would long precede his return, he was also recognizing that human beings have certain tendencies. Like sheep, they follow false messiahs down the path to war, and they're inclined to accept the inevitability of war. But the red horse also has its roots in human nature and human answers to problems. Historian Victor Davis Hanson notes, conflict will remain the familiar father of us all as long as human nature stays constant and unchanging over time and across space and cultures. His conclusion is that war is an entirely human enterprise. The red horse represents the human tendency to rely on force rather than peace. Former U.S. President Dwight D. Eisenhower addressed the harsh realities of war when he said,
every gun that is made, every warship launched, every rocket fired signifies, in the final sense, a theft from those who hunger and are not fed, those who are cold and are not clothed. This world in arms is not spending money alone. It is spending the sweat of its laborers, the genius of its scientists, the hope of its children. We pay for a single fighter plane with 500,000 bushels of wheat. We pay for a single destroyer with new homes that could have housed more than 8,000 people. This is not a way of life at all, in any true sense. Under the cloud of threatening war, it is humanity hanging from a cross of iron.
War is an ongoing part of our present human condition, and war leads directly to the third dwindle. War causes disruption of food production and distribution chains. People are often unable to buy what little remains, and desperation and theft spread quickly. In the first century, a denarius would be about a day's wages, and wheat for human consumption was generally more valuable than barley, which was mostly used for animal feed. The comment about not harming the oil and wine may be ironic if suppliers were profiting from producing more lucrative items like wine and oil and cutting back on staple foods, making famine worse. Devastating food shortages certainly happened centuries later in the collapse of the Roman Empire as invading tribes attacked the overextended superpower. In the 19th century, the black horse also appeared in sequence after the white and red horses when the Chinese false messiah Hung Shu Quan promoted himself as savior and went to war with his countrymen for 15 years. During that time, an estimated 20 to 30 million are thought to have died, mostly from famine and its natural consequence, epidemic disease. Joseph Stalin went to war with his fellow citizens in 1929, when he launched an attack on Soviet farmers. He was determined to wipe them out as a class. This led to a catastrophic famine and the death of 5 to 8 million people. In a similar move, Mao Zedong declared a war of sorts on his own people, a violent attempt to advance China industrially on the backs of the populace. Between 1958 and 1960, Mao ordered the nation's agricultural sector to produce as much food as possible so that it could be exported to the Soviet Union in exchange for industrial help. False claims were made about the country's improving productive capacity, and critically needed foods were exported. By 1961, farm laborers were being forced into industrial production. But bad weather, poor harvests, and a diminished workforce brought about the death of almost 38 million from starvation and overwork. Mao refused to accept that his policies had caused the worst famine in Chinese, if not world, history. Instead, he blamed those party officials who criticized his ideas. The black horse and its rider represent terrible famines that have destroyed millions of lives in one more chapter in the history of human tragedy. Let's emphasize that many of these deaths were caused by delusional leaders. But it's not just lack of food that leads to famine. The precursor is sometimes a lack of water. Tragically, a child dies from hunger-related causes every 6 seconds. Fresh water is currently under threat for almost 80% of the world's population. Without adequate water supplies, food cannot be produced. Population growth and increasing prosperity are exerting demands on resources that cannot be withstood. Without coordinated strategies, the potential for disastrous consequences looms. The Earth has a fixed amount of water, of which 97% is salt water and only about 3% is fresh. Of the fresh water, only 1/3 of it is accessible. The rest is trapped in ice and glaciers. In terms of freshwater consumption, agriculture alone accounts for 70%. Added to this is the reality that the three largest countries by population, China, India, and the United States, are engaged in unsustainable water use in grain-growing areas. Complicating matters is the fact that both meat consumption and population are increasing. Industrialized meat production is far more water-intensive than grain production. So without radical changes in eating patterns, the already high amount of water needed for about ongoing conditions that would typify the world's decline. And he warned not to be deceived into thinking it's the end when false messiahs, war, and famine disrupt the world. Now he gave a fourth condition, which, like the others, signals only the beginning of the process that leads to the end. He said, and there will be pestilences in various places. This parallels the fourth horseman's ride. His horse is gray-green or yellowish-green, like the color of so many who are sick and dying. The rider's name is Death, the death that comes from pestilences, epidemics, and plagues. Opportunistic infections and sickness often come in the wake of war and famine. Malnutrition means that the immune system is suppressed in a way that's very like the collapse of the body under a full-blown attack of AIDS. Illnesses that are rare find a foothold that healthy people would normally resist. Under famine conditions, mortality rates may be greater by many times than normal. And during and after wars, epidemics can spread quickly. In the 1600s, the 30 Years' War saw typhus kill millions before it was halted. It returned with a vengeance in World War I, when millions more died in Russia, Poland, and Romania. And the Spanish flu of 1918-1919 may have killed as many as 100 million globally as soldiers returned home from that same war in Europe. In John's apocalyptic vision, the pale horse's rider is accompanied by Hades, the grave, the last resting place of the terminally ill. Then comes this summary statement about what the four horsemen have caused in total in terms of human life. And power was given to them over a fourth of the earth to kill with sword, with hunger, with death, and by the beasts of the earth. In combination, the riders of the four horses bring death to 25% of the world's population. It's a sickening statistic, even more so when you realize that much of it comes at man's own hand. The Four Horsemen's ride began some 2,000 years ago and continues to this day. Yet despite all the terrible death and destruction they bring, there is good news at the end of their terrible ride. The same Jesus who showed the meaning of the mysterious four riders will also come to put an end to their destruction. As the true Messiah, he will replace the white horseman's final false Messiah and his false prophet. He will establish a society based on truth, not deception. Christ will also come as the Prince of Peace to eradicate the war and violence brought on by the red horseman. One of Christ's other names is Yahweh Yireh, the faithful God who provides. So at his return, he will end famine by providing rainfall in the right season and abundant yields of food. At that time, epidemic disease and sickness in general will give way to the work of Christ, who's also named Yahweh Rapha, the faithful God who heals. Then the four horsemen will be no more, and the effects of their destructive ride across the earth will be a remnant of the past to be quickly forgotten.
There goes my mind racing, and you are the reason that I'm still breathing. I'm hoping.